Number 10, Hellbound. We live in a great timeline right now, especially with all these boomer shooters coming out, and Hellbound is one of them. It's just a nice, fun little romp through hell, just a nice tribute to Doom where you play as this uber manly dude who's gonna stop all the forces of hell and save the day. It's just a lot of fun. You get your big guns, you go find your secrets and all that cool stuff. You know what I like about it? I like the color palette they use. It's just very colorful, very nice. And just, of course, you have, you know, your heavy metal soundtrack, which was okay, but nothing inspiring. It doesn't compare to any of, like, the classics, like, you know, from Bobby Prince or even the moderns like Andrew Holschult and stuff like that. It wasn't, like, spectacular, but, like, it got you in the right mood to go kill some demons. And I liked the level design of it. It had some really creative parts. And I remember there was this one mission where it was just this wide open area and you had to go find these keys. I mean, you could get a little lost at moments, but it was still fun. It was still just a nice playthrough going around and just killing all these demons. And there isn't too much I can say about this game because I think it's a nice tribute to the old school games, again, especially Doom. But at the same time, there wasn't anything exciting or new about it. It was just kind of like just another boomer shooter with, you know, going through hell and fighting demons. But the stuff that they had in there was really fun. I liked using the guns. I liked the power-ups. I liked the enemies you faced. There was just a lot of fun to be had. But again, I can't say too much about it just because it just felt very, like, traditional. There was, like, it's nice to do a nice tribute, but sometimes you want to put a spin on it, you know? But I still had fun with it. I think another thing is that the campaign was surprisingly short. Like, I even asked the guys themselves on Twitter, I'm like, was that the actual main campaign? And they said, yeah. I'm like, I mean, okay. I mean, there's nothing wrong with a campaign that's, like, short at times because that's, like, an easy playthrough. But other times, I was craving more. I wanted to see what else this game had to offer. But I mean, for what we got, it's fine. I just had a lot of fun with it. Again, it's nothing special, but if you're just looking for another, like, Doom-styled game, you can't go wrong with this game. Number 9. Streets of Rage 4. This game came out of nowhere. I was so shocked that Sega actually decided to make a new Streets of Rage game, because I think they attempted something in the past to revive this series, but nothing ever came of it. But I'm just happy we were able to get it now. I was very late to the party with Streets of Rage, because obviously Nintendo kid, but, you know, thanks to the Virtual Console, I was able to play it, and my friend Eric, he introduced me to this series, and it's just like, wow, I really missed out on these games, especially because they had such an awesome style, and the music, of course, mwah, it's grade A stuff. I absolutely love it. I think, like everybody, too, Streets of Rage 2 is probably my favorite in the series. Streets of Rage 4, I don't know if it's better than 2. I'd have to play 2 again. I haven't played it in a while, but I mean, from what I played of Streets of Rage 4, it was just a lot of fun, and being able to play as these as your favorite characters again, like Axel and Blaze, and then you had all these newcomers as well. And of course, the presentation is top-notch, with an excellent soundtrack, an excellent art style. It was just really nice. The story is very simple. I thought they were going to go into in more depth about all these characters and stuff. But you know what? It's a simple beat 'em up. That's kind of the way it was back then, where you just have characters, they're going into action, and there's no time for all these character moments. You just got to keep on going, beating the crap out of everybody. It's just a tribute to a time when arcade games just ruled supreme, especially with the beat-em-up genre. Of course, like I said, the plot is very straightforward. It involves Mr. X's kids, the X and Y twins, and they're doing the same stuff. They're trying to take over the city, and it's up to Axel and the gang to stop them. And yeah, the mechanics are very solid. It just feels nice to hit things. The thing I like, too, that they introduced is you can use the special moves now, but how it works is you do the special move, and if you can hit some more enemies and not get hit yourself, you actually regain that health, which I think is a much better sort of, like, reward system for actually playing good, where like in the original you just keep draining your health and then you can't use it, where I think being able to use the special moves adds a lot more dynamic gameplay, and like I like the risk and reward system that comes with it, so I thought it was really good. And you got some cool locations, you got some cool boss fights, there's actually a lot of options, and you can unlock a lot of characters, including playing as, you know, the classic skins of all the characters and stuff. It's really cool. There's a lot of neat stuff in this game. It's nothing like spectacular, it's just your standard beat-em-up, but with just a little nice flair in that, and it's nice for, like, especially with friends. I think that's the best way to go about it. I mean, I don't have any friends in the immediate area, sad me, but, I mean, not that we would get together now in these times, of course, again, FU 2020. But yeah, it was just a fun time revisiting this classic franchise. I would love to see more classic Sega games come back, like maybe new Golden Axe or something like that. I don't know. But again, Streets of Rage, my heart was definitely close to it. And just, it was great to go back and visit these characters again and take part in all these great battles. There's not too much more I can say with it. Check it out. Number 8, Kingdom Hearts Melody of Memories. I did a whole video with Zoriel Diamond on it, so if you want my full thoughts on it, you can go watch that. But I think it was a fun time. It wasn't anything, like, amazing or anything, but the whole thing with this game is it's not trying to be another full-blown, like, Kingdom Hearts game. The idea behind it is just kind to reminisce about older games, you know? I call it Yoko Shimura's greatest hits, because that's what it is. It's all of some of her best works in this series put onto this game, and then you just have to time everything to the rhythm, and I thought that stuff was done really well in this game. It's just nice to go back and relive all these classic moments again. So that's the way you kind of have to approach it. It's not supposed to be like another big game, although there is new story development, which it's not much, but it's there, and it kind of sets up future events. The thing is, like, I know a lot of people don't like the story, but the fact that it's so off the wall and so batshit, that's part of the charm to the story for this series, you know? But again, this game, it's more about reliving the past and just going back and remembering all the good times you had with the older games, and that's what I really got out of it. I think the best way to enjoy it is on the Switch, because it's a game you can just easily pick up and play, and for that, I thought it was fun. I thought towards the end is where it got stale, though, because it goes on far too long, and the main mechanics, like, once you get into them in the first few levels, that's really about it. Like, they do try to change it up at some points, but it isn't, like, drastically different. I thought the final battle against Master Xehanort is where it got bad, because there was so much stuff going on screen, you couldn't line up when you had to hit the notes at the right moment. It's like, I know you have the music, but you also have to hit it up on the screen, but again, there was just so much going on, you couldn't pay attention to it. It's like, why did they even do that? I know they were trying to make it epic and like, oh, it's the final battle against Master Xehanort again and all that stuff, but I don't know, it was just too much. But I feel like this game is best enjoyed in increments. I feel like if you try to play it all in one go, you'll get burnt out. So yeah, this is definitely one of those games. I feel like the best way to experience it is on the Switch, so that you can just pick up and play it wherever you want, because I don't think there's any substantial differences between versions or anything like that. I don't know, I haven't played the others, but yeah, again, if you like Kingdom Hearts, you'll definitely enjoy this, especially for the soundtrack. I mean, you can't go wrong with Kingdom Hearts music. Say what you will about this franchise, it's just the soundtrack has always been 100% awesomeness. Number 7, Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 1 and 2 Remastered. I mean, it is a remaster, but from what I understand, it was remade entirely with the Unreal 4 engine. If I'm not mistaken, I'm sure maybe they brought over some assets from the original game. I'm not entirely sure on that, but either way, I thought Tony Hawk's skating franchise was done for. I thought, especially after 5, and then they did, I think, like a mobile game or something. Like, this was it. We were never going to get another one of these. But this one was a big surprise, just like Streets of Rage 4. And I couldn't be more thankful for it, because I hear it's been getting good reviews. So I would like to think that the Tony Hawk franchise is back. You know, I loved playing those games as a kid, like especially the first three. I haven't played much of the Underground games. I hear they're really good too, but yeah, they came out at just the right time because it was kind of like, it was like with skateboarding in general, where you're trying to be cool, trying to be rebellious. You're in that teenage years, and this was the good answer for those of us that didn't have, quite that mobility and skill like them, the actual skaters that go out and perform all those crazy tricks. This is a nice alternative for us nerds that were at home playing video games. And I love it, especially for, you know, that killer soundtrack, especially with songs like Superman and all that stuff. And just being able to play those old games again with a whole new facelift, it was just, oh, it's just so good. It took me back to my youth, man. It was just so much fun. Just being able to skate around, collect all the letters, find all the VHS tapes. It's such a simple concept, but something about it worked because it inspires multiple playthroughs. You can't just do it in one go. I'm sure there's speedrunners out there who could, but the fun of it is going around and skating in all of these really cool parks. Then, of course, you have all the challenges and you can make your own parks. It was just so much fun. The thing that I just found weird about it was, I don't know if the physics are different compared to when they first came out. There was something weird about them, but I got used to it eventually, although I did have to turn on some handicaps to help me out because I'm really bad at the game. I just kept falling over all the time, even after sort of learning all the stunts. But, you know, it's training wheels. I'm not trying to go for all the crazy scores. I'm just want to have fun and re-experience this game. And of course it looks great too, remastered as well. They did such a good job of it. Looks nice on Unreal 4. And they got most of the music back from the original game, which is always a plus. Because again, that music from those first two games, it's kind of what gave it its identity. And I just had a lot of fun with it. I was just like, oh, I just got so giddy playing it. Because I love the Tony Hawk games. I love playing them back in the day. 3 is probably my favorite, so I would love for 3 to be remastered next, because I believe the first two were successful enough, they got good reviews, so I don't know how they did in sales, but hopefully it's enough where we can get a proper 3 remastered, you know? I would love it so much. But yeah, there's not too much more I can say on it. If you've never experienced the greatness that is Tony Hawk, you should definitely check it out. It just ushered in a whole new wave of these, like, sort of, like, skating games or, like, board games. Not board games like Monopoly or stuff like that, but where you're riding on, like a snowboard or you're biking and stuff like that. I mean, who knows? There could be a Tony Hawk's Pro Skater board game for all I know. I mean, we got Monopoly games of, like, everything under the sun, like Fortnite and all that stuff. So, who knows, right? But yeah, I would definitely recommend Tony Hawk if you're looking for something a little bit different. If you're looking for like a unique sports game or something like that, then Tony Hawk, it's definitely the way to go. Number 6, Animal Crossing New Horizon. Boy, this game came out at just the right time because I believe this was before the first shutdown. So it was nice to have this game where you could pretend to just go back out into the world without a care in the world and interact with all these really cool characters and stuff like that. It's just, the Animal Crossing series is just a nice franchise. It's just nonchalant. You can just really relax in this world and do whatever you want. There's like, I mean, sometimes there are consequences, but for the most part, it's just stress-free and you're going about your lives in it. And this game delivers just as much as the others. I don't know if it's my favorite, because I do really like New Leaf and being able to be the mayor and all that stuff. But at the same time, you kind of don't have that pressure of being a mayor. You can just kind of go out and do what you want, pretty much. So, I don't know. The thing I really like in the new Animal Crossing is, of course, the crafting system, which I think they took a little inspiration from Breath of the Wild. Just a little bit. But I think it's just a fun way to go out and get all new furniture and stuff, because you have to find the right items, and then you come back, and then you just start hammering away, and you build something that's really nice for your house. So the other thing I like, too, is the inclusion of the Nook Points, and how you have to go out in the world and perform a specific task, which I think it's kind of a good way to sort of encourage you to explore the world, and then sort of get your own rhythm going. And I believe later on in the game, you can customize the island any way you want, which is really neat. I haven't got super far in it though, unfortunately, because as much as I like Animal Crossing, there are times where I'm just like, yeah, I know, it's the, it's Animal Crossing. You just go around, making your home look really nice, your gardens, your stuff like that, making new friends, and, I mean, it's pretty much the same thing on a day-to-day basis, and, like, after a while, you kind of want to move on to something else, but at the same time, I do want to go back eventually, and I'm sure my town's a mess right now that I'm not there. It's like, these entire towns, they always depend on one person being there, or else it's in complete ruin, it's gonna go up in flames, there's so much pressure for a game about interacting with cute little animals, it's like, oh, I can't take it, man. But yeah, for the most part, I enjoyed it. It was a lot of fun. I would like to go back to it eventually. Maybe go visit more of my friends online and stuff like that. So, if you're looking for something that's stress-free, you can't go wrong with Animal Crossing, man. Number 5. Hyrule Warriors: Age of Calamity. I played a bit of the original Hyrule Warriors. It was a fun game. I really liked it. I've never played any of the Dynasty Warrior games, but it looks like they did a good job at representing the Zelda franchise. And Age of Calamity does the same with Breath of the Wild. I think they did such a good job with representing Breath of the Wild, just because they used the map from the game, and then you get to go and choose certain missions, and they include elements like... you know, the spells Link has, like, the magnet and the bombs and stuff like that. Like, yeah, they just did such a good job, including the art style as well. It's really, really nice. And, yeah, the gameplay was just as invigorating as ever, just like with the original Hyrule Warriors. And I think what's nice is, I mean, it does a whole lot better job than Samurai Jack did, just because you have all these multiple characters, there are a lot of different strategies that you use throughout each battle. It's just satisfying destroying wave after wave of enemies. I was just able to really get into it, and there were a decent amount of characters that I liked to pick during the battle. I just was really getting into it, and there were tiny moments of frame rate issues, but I think they released a patch to fix that, so for the most part it ran pretty fine. I mean, I've had a few hiccups here and there, but again, I think just the amount of creativity and just fun of each battle just really, really kept me engaged the whole way through. And the music is definitely miles above the original Breath of the Wild, which I didn't think was bad. It kind of fit the slow atmosphere of Breath of the Wild. But here, there was a lot of epic scores that just really pumped you up for the fights and defeating Calamity Ganon and all that stuff. So, I guess my main issue with the game is the story, because it completely takes, like, a 180. So, I mean, it starts out as a proper prequel to Breath of the Wild, you know, 100 years before the whole Calamity stuff. But then they decided to shoehorn in the champions from the future coming to help, creating an alternative timeline, and I think it was just handled so poorly and haphazardly. Like, there are some good moments in the story, like, there's some good cutscenes between the characters and all that stuff, but, yeah, it's just once they come in, it just felt really half-assed. Like, I get it, that little thing, little guardian that came from the future, he made it happen. But still, it was kind of like, okay, he was able, I mean, he could create a portal to send himself back in time. But, all of a sudden, he's able to do this now. And they really don't spend a lot of time with the future guardians interacting with the past guardians. Like, they have some character moments, but I feel like they didn't push it all the way. But even then, it just still felt half-assed to me with how they did it and stuff. And even then, they're kind of not, like, surprised by this. It's like, whoa, wait, you come from the future? Okay, we stop everything we're doing here. Like, well, of course, after the battles, like, we gotta talk about this. This is insane. But they're just kind of like, okay, they came from the future. Okay, they're here to help us. That's great. It's just like, yeah, the story just got, like, really weird and really hokey towards the end. So it just takes place in an alternative timeline. Again, so I think the first half is where it's really good, because it kind of deals with all of the characters and kind of, like, getting a chance to know them. And, what's the name of that one that looks like Falco from Star Fox? Put his name up on screen. I think it's, like, Ravelli or something. I don't know. I'll put it up on screen. But, he was just as annoying as ever. And people have explained to me why he is, because the other champion, because he had to, like, work to get to where he was. But even so, it's like, there has to be some, like, ability with a character. They have to have something that really connects you with them, but here he's just like, it's like, oh no, I'm the best, and oh no, this knight that's assisting Princess Zelda is just, oh, he's the worst, he's not gonna do anything. It's just like, okay, we get it, you're an asshole. Like, I think even Falco himself would just be like, hey man, tone it down a little bit. I don't know, the weird thing of I still have, like, issue with, though, is, like, and of course, it's nothing against the actress. I'm sure she's really nice. It's just, Zelda, the voice they make for Zelda, just, I don't know. I don't know if it fits. And I get it, she's struggling with her powers and all that stuff. But, I don't know, something about it just feels off to me. It just sounds like she's crying all the time, even when she's not supposed to be. So, again, it's no offense to any of the voice actors. They do a fine job. I mean, especially Link. He gives the best performance of all, Silence, you know. Oh, but I can't. But again, everyone did a good job with the voice acting, but I definitely felt that the second half of the game story is where it kind of fell flat for me. And I mean, I guess it could get a little bit repetitive towards the end because it does go on for quite a while, but I don't know. Again, that gameplay, I was really into it and just had a lot of fun being able to just kick the shit out of moblins over and over again. And I guess that is a problem too, because, I mean, there is variety, but it's mostly the same monsters. They're just like reskin and stuff like that, which I guess that kind of got old real fast, but I guess it was a way to sort of like save time as well, so I don't know. At the end of the day, I really enjoyed Hyrule Warriors. It was a lot of fun. Again, I've never played the Dynasty Warriors games. I'm sure they're good. Well, now that I've played this game, it'll make me want to go back and play them. So, I don't know if they're going to do something like a sequel now because with this new timeline stuff and all that. But if they did, I'd still be interested to see where it goes.
We'll finish up the list in the next video. Take care. Bye.